been preaching the last few Sundays concerning the gifts of the Spirit. And we have covered the word of knowledge, the word of wisdom. And today we come down to discerning of spirits. So 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. Verses 7 through 10. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another diverse kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. Now, notice that it is not the gift, it is not nine different gifts, each one of them just given to various individuals, but it's the manifestation of the Spirit that is given. The making known of the power and the work and the blessings of the Spirit of God of the Holy Ghost. Someone may say, well, I have the gift of healing. Well, with all due respect, I beg your pardon, the Holy Ghost still has that gift. He is the one who does it. He's the one who operates it. But we should desire, we should be zealous, we should seek to be close enough to God that He can, the Holy Ghost can work whichever of these gifts He desires through any Spirit-filled person. And this is not so we can put on a sideshow, but the purpose is, first of all, to glorify God. Amen. Amen. And second, to minister to one another. That's what these gifts are all about. Now, I believe that these nine gifts fall into three different categories. And I think we see that expressed in the next chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 2, where it said, "And though I have the gift of prophecy, and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so that I could remove mountains and have not charity, I am nothing." I believe that knowledge here is a revelation gift, that faith is a power gift, and prophecy is an utterance gift, or a gift of speech or utterance. And going back to 1 Corinthians 12, I believe there are three revelation gifts among these nine, and that's a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge, discerning of spirits, three power gifts, faith, gifts of healing, working of miracles, and three utterance gifts, prophecy, diverse kinds of tongues, and interpretation of tongues. So we've been looking at the revelation gifts, a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge, and today we come to discerning of spirits. Now, some time ago, I don't know, maybe 3-4 years ago, I preached on 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And I encourage you to take a glance at that chapter, even right now if you want to, in your Bibles. I'm not going to read all of that. But I believe 1 Corinthians 2, chapter 2, deals in detail with all three of these revelation gifts. That is knowledge, wisdom, discerning of spirits. For instance, I will read verses 12 through 14. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 12 through 14. Now, we have received not the spirit of this world, but the Spirit which is of God. Could somebody say Holy Ghost?
Holy Ghost.
That we might know. Okay, word of knowledge. That we might know the things that are freely given to us by God.
Amen.
Talking about the gifts of the Spirit. Amen. One of them being the word of knowledge, which things are also we speak, having to do with utterance. Not in the words which man's wisdom, word of wisdom, do you see that? Teacheth. But that which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. Now all of this can be summed up under the phrase divine revelation. Amen. Word of wisdom, word of knowledge. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, and here it is, because they are spiritually
discerned.
Discerned.
Amen.
So here you have reference to the gifts of the Spirit and the revelation gifts that help us understand the things of God, a word of knowledge, a word of wisdom, and discerning of spirits. The spiritual man has a discernment concerning spiritual truths to which the natural man is blind and ignorant. The natural man cannot understand the things of God. You need the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Amen. So many glorious benefits.
Oh, yes.
Thank God for being born again.
Yes.
What can be more wonderful than knowing my past sins are forgiven. Thank God for the experience of sanctification.
Yes.
That enables us to live a holy life and not have to sin again. That's wonderful.
Oh, yes. Thank you.
But thank God for the baptism of the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah.
That enhances the comfort of God in our life. That enhances our prayer life to where when we don't know just what to pray or ask for, He makes groanings for us with intercession that cannot be uttered. Thank God for the baptism of the Holy Ghost that endues us with a power to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. And on and on and on. But thank God for the Holy Ghost that leads and guides us into all truth. Amen. The revelation gives. Praise His name. Now, in the Old Testament, the Spirit of God certainly at times would come upon certain individuals temporarily, and then it may leave them, not coming to dwell in them, and enable them to perform some spiritual task. And even so it is with the gift of discernment. We talked about Solomon. In 1 Kings 3 and 9, give therefore thy servant an understanding heart to judge thy people, that I may discern between good and bad.
Right.
So this discernment has to do with knowing the difference between the good and the bad.
Amen.
For who is able, Solomon said, to judge this thy so great a people? The prophet Ezekiel said, and they shall teach my people the difference between the holy and the profane, and cause them to discern between the unclean and the clean. Amen. But we need, it's important as children of God that we be able to know the difference between good and evil. Between the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. To know, to be able to have a supernatural discernment concerning the spirits of people. Now, I know in the natural, people may think they discern all kinds of things about other people. And they may be right, they may be wrong. But thank God the Holy Ghost is always right.
Amen.
And I tell you, if you exercise so-called discernment and you express that, and it's the natural man, if you're not on target, you can stir up a hornet's nest right quick. You know, I discern that you're not what you should be. I discern that you're really doing something behind people's back. Now, I'm talking about in the natural, you can cause problems. But there are times when there is a supernatural work of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
And these gifts are not meant to destroy people.
Amen.
But to edify.
Yes.
To help.
Yes.
And sometimes this comes, if there is a heretic and one who is not teachable, that is out to destroy people, sometimes the gift might work to help protect. Amen. Not just that you're trying to destroy the heretic, he's condemned already. But rather, to discern in a way to where he will not have a detrimental effect upon others so as to destroy them.
Right.
So we see this even in the Old Testament at times. But that spirit, the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of God in the Old Testament, that would come down on one here and one there, and not dwell, but leave, and it be gone, and maybe there be a spiritual discernment. Joel prophesied that Holy Ghost would be poured out upon all flesh.
Yes.
And he can come and dwell within us. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
You can be so full of the Spirit of God that any time that there is a need to be able to tell the difference in who's right and who's wrong, the Holy Ghost, he'll kick in and he'll enable you to do that. Isn't that wonderful?
Amen.
Praise God. Not just that we want to judge people, but we don't want to be misled.
That's right.
We don't want to be deceived.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
And thank God for without the Holy Ghost, you are in jeopardy. You're so much more vulnerable to deception.
Yes.
So many false prophets out there that are not teaching what the Word of God is saying or what that it really means. Mm-hmm. And so it's important to have a supernatural power that enables us to know right from wrong.
Oh, yes.
So as we see this in the Old Testament and then coming into the New Testament, Peter said in his writing, 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, he says, "But there were false prophets," referring back to the Old Testament. "But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction, and many shall follow their pernicious ways. By reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. It's a lazy. Never cease to be amazed. Somebody can call their preacher and put themselves a preacher and put the word church on top of a building. And they can proclaim any kind of doctrine that they want to. And somebody will follow them. We don't want to be victims so as to follow the wrong people and be led the wrong way. Now, thank God for anybody anywhere that's preaching, preaching God's truth. But everybody's not doing that. And you can be misled. In the name of a preacher or a church, many times the truth is being evil spoken of. So there's a need for discernment. In John's first letter, 1 John chapter 4, verses 1, 2 and 3, John said, "Beloved, believe not every spirit." Uh-huh. "But try the spirits, whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world."
Amen.
"Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist,
right,
whereof you have heard that it should come, and even now already is it in the world." So almost 2,000 years ago, in the time of the early church, the spirit of Antichrist was already at work.
Right.
Now most people, when they hear the word Antichrist, they think of a certain stage of Satan's reign that's yet to come. But actually the spirit of Antichrist has been around for a long time. And it inspires these heretics to proclaim false doctrine and deceive people and lead them the wrong way. We're living in the last days. Jesus is coming soon. Do you believe that?
Yes.
The stage is being set, Brother Benizer. As you were sharing with me, the stage is being set.
Yes.
I don't know, but what the Antichrist may be living right now.
Yeah, that's true.
I believe that we're getting that close. And on the political scene, the stage is being set.
Yes, it is.
You need the baptism of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Because without it, evil men and seducers are going to wax worse and worse. And the spirit of Antichrist that was at work even in the early church,
right,
been at work ever since then, is at work now. The Holy Ghost will help protect people from being vulnerable to the spirit of the Antichrist. And without it, you don't want to be a victim that will listen to the program of the Antichrist. And we might not know who he is, or he might not yet be born. He may be born. If he is born, he may not yet even have a political position as far as a natural man in the flesh. But in the spirit world, amen. That's been around a long time, and it's already at work. And we need protection against that spirit. Hallelujah. And that's when Jesus is He was on this earth. The Son of God, the Son of Man, God with us. He taught us the words of His Father. He is full of grace and truth. And thank God for His teachings that are in this book. But as He was going back to the Father, He knew that while He was going back to the Father, that spirit of Antichrist would still be working right back here.
Yeah.
And that's one of the reasons that he said, I'm going back to the Father, but I'm going to send the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
And He will lead you. He will guide you into all truth. Amen. You see, there's a spiritual warfare that's going on. Just as surely as the spirit of Antichrist is at work, there is the Holy Spirit of God that's at work, the blessed Holy Ghost. And you tell me who's going to win. Oh, Lord, help me here. You know what I'm talking about. But there's some credit card. What is it? It said, don't leave home without it. Okay, whatever. But don't leave home without it. Oh, my, I wouldn't want to leave home without the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Praise God, praise God.
Amen.
I'm not trying to be harsh or condemn anybody. I'm telling you some good news.
Yes.
I'm telling you about the provision of God, of our good God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Yes. That He's provided a way that we can know what's right, what's wrong, what's true, what's false. The difference between the spirit of the Antichrist, the spirit of truth, and the spirit of error. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, as we go further in the 1 Corinthians, after this 12th chapter will be the 13th chapter about love, which is the greatest gift of all. But then still dealing with this, in 1 Corinthians 14, and mainly dwelling on the utterance gifts, of prophecy, tongues, and interpretation of tongues. But in the latter part of that chapter, it said, let the prophets speak two or three. Now, this is not referring to an office in the church, no more than them having an office of interpreter. When there's a message, an interpretation, says, if there be no interpreter present, that's not talking about somebody that has the office of interpreter. It's talking about if the gift of interpretation does not work through anyone. And so the prophets here is referring to whomever the gift of prophecy is working through.
Right.
Those who are anointed by God to speak a message from Him. And it said, let the prophets speak two or three, and let the other judge. Now that word judge in the original language comes from the same root word as the word discern. Amen? So don't accept something just because so-and-so with letters from A to Z behind his name said it. You need the Holy Ghost to help you discern. And of course you need to get into the Word of God. You need to pray. The Spirit and the Word will agree. The Holy Ghost can help you to understand the Word of God, to where if something is presented contrary to that, that you'll be able to discern. So when the prophets speak, I believe the most common manifestation of the gift of prophecy is preaching. I don't believe that's the only manifestation. I believe that any time someone speaks and the Holy Ghost gives them the option and the anointing, that's the gift of a prophecy operating. But when the prophets speak, instead of just accepting it, and, it doesn't matter if a part of their title is apostle so-and-so. It doesn't matter if a part of their title, this is a prophet, John. What matters is that you have the Holy Ghost and it enables you to understand the word and to discern when the prophets speak, let the other judge. Let them discern. And this is in a chapter, the 14th chapter, still dealing with the gifts of the Spirit. So when the gift of prophecy operates, it's important that those who hear, that the gift of discernment operate through them. Amen.
Amen.
I thank God in our General Assembly, say this past year, in the selection of the General Overseer. Did you know people can be in unanimous agreement with one another, and that does not necessarily mean that they're right?
Amen.
There are cults where all the members of that cult may see eye to eye and believe the same thing. But what we're after is it seemeth good to the Holy Ghost and us.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So, we need not just what some get in their mind that the gifts are not working, unless it is that manifested in a spectacular way, like a sideshow, almost. Let me tell you, the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, the discerning of spirits,
yeah,
are just as important gifts as the working of miracles.
Amen.
They're all in order.
Amen.
And the Bible said concerning our business,
yeah,
not slothful in business, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord.
Amen.
In our business sessions, we need all of the gifts of the Spirit.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Don't rule out tongues and interpretation of tongues from our business sessions. But when they operate, or when the gift of prophecy operates, or when there's a word of wisdom or a word of knowledge, we need the opportunity for the gift of discernment.
Yes.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Not just to say, sound like they're speaking in tongues, and somebody, I didn't understand what they're saying. Somebody said something in English after it, so whatever they said in English, that must really be God. No. Not necessarily so.
That's right.
Amen. Preferably so.
Yes.
But we need to discern. Well, we need the gift of discernment. So, Paul wrote to the Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 19 through 21. He said, quench not the Spirit. We don't want to throw a blanket or water on the fire of the Holy Ghost. That's not what we're talking about. Quench not the Spirit. Despise not prophesying. But then he said, prove all things. Hold fast that which is good.
Amen.
And even so, he wrote to the Ephesians in chapter 5, verse 10, saying, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord. The church at Ephesus in the book of Revelation, they did such proving. Revelation chapter 2, verse 1, unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write. And then verse 2, I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars. In Jesus' ministry, he gave instruction concerning this. In the Sermon on the Mount, for instance, Matthew 7 and 15, he said, beware of false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. We need to be able to know the difference between a sheep and a shepherd and a wolf. Jesus, in the chapter so many of us are familiar with, Matthew chapter 24, he said in verse 5, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Well, verse 4 before that, he just said, take heed that no man deceive you. Mm-hmm. And in verse 11, and many false prophets shall arise, right, and shall deceive many.
Amen.
He foretold of those maybe in a desert, a place of which someone would say, Christ is out there in the desert. And he let us know that we need to be careful lest we be deceived. After Christ went back to heaven, we see this gift of discernment operating in the early church. Acts 1 and 8, ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. Now, instead of Acts 1 and 8, you can go to Acts 8 and 1 and read of the persecution that came upon the church there in Jerusalem until they all fled except for the apostles. And there is the deacon Philip comes to Samaria and preaches the gospel. There's a great revival. Many saved, many baptized. But as yet, none of them had received the Holy Ghost. And it was not God's will for there to be a Jewish church and a Samaritan church. And by his providence, he made a divine connection of Samaria with the general headquarters in Jerusalem. And that was that when Jerusalem heard about it, they sent the apostles Peter and John there. And we read in Acts chapter 8, verse 14, now when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent unto them Peter and John, who when they were come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. For as yet he was not fallen upon none of them, only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then laid they their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. And Simon, Simon being known as some great one, and when Simon saw that through laying on the apostles' hands the Holy Ghost was given, he offered them money, saying, give me also this power, that on whomsoever I shall lay hands, he may receive the Holy Ghost. But Peter said unto him, you're the gift of discernment worked through Simon Peter.
Yeah.
When Simon wanted to buy, not Simon Peter, but the Simon the sorcerer, wanted to buy the Holy Ghost with money, Peter said unto him, now, I'm not going to stand in this pulpit and say it the way some modern versions do. Thank God for the King James Version. Peter said, thy money perish with thee. But one version said, that he told Simon where to go with his money. But he said, thy money perish with thee, because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money. Thou hast neither part nor lot in this matter, for thy heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent therefore of this thy wickedness, and pray God if perhaps the thought of thine heart may be forgiven thee. Notice this, verse 23. For I perceive.
Perceive.
That's the gift of discernment. For I perceive that thou art in the gall of bitterness and in the bond of iniquity. Another occurrence on one of Paul's missionary journeys in Acts chapter 16. Verse 16. And it came to pass as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination, divination met us, which brought her masters much gain by her soothsaying. The same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God. Well, that sounded pretty good. Said Paul and his missionary partners were the servants of the Most High God. She said, which show unto us the way of salvation. And this did she many days. But Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out of her that very hour. No, nobody had whispered in his ear except the Holy Ghost. And let him know what spirit that woman was of. So later Peter warned us in his second letter, chapter 3, verse 17, to beware lest ye also being led away with the error of the wicked fall from your own steadfastness. Paul wrote to young Timothy, 1 Timothy 4 and 1, now the Spirit speaketh expressly, that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. Paul, in his second letter to the Corinthian church, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 3, he said, but I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. And then down in verse 13, he continued his warning in saying, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. Paul wrote to the Thessalonians, the second letter to them, in chapter 2, verse 3, and said, let no man deceive you by any means. For that day shall not come, except there be a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. Skipping down to verse 9, he said, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. For this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie. Thank God for the Holy Ghost that leads and guides to all truth. We need to be able to discern and know the voice of God. Jesus said in John chapter 10, my sheep, they know my voice.
Amen.
And a stranger they will not follow. Amen.
Amen.
Would you stand with me? Almighty God, we thank you for your word today. Not only for your word, we thank you for your spirit, for the blessed Holy Ghost. Hallelujah, that you've sent him to indwell us. Yes, Lord, first and foremost, we thank you for forgiveness of sin and salvation. Lord, not only for amazing grace that saved a wretch like me, oh God, but for your enabling grace, a day by day that gives us victory over sin. But Lord, we want to share this with others. Oh God, we don't want to be led astray. And you provided all the blessings of the baptism of the Holy Ghost for us. And I pray, God, as we share concerning these gifts of the Spirit, hallelujah, that it will whet the spiritual appetite for someone who has been saved or sanctified but does not yet have the fullness of the Spirit. Oh, God, that they'd say, oh, I see where I need that. I want it. I desire it. For, Lord, you tell us to desire it. May it be so in Jesus' name. Amen.